We're on problem 129. 129. If n is a positive integer, is the value of b minus a at least? Okay, so n is positive. N positive integer. And they're saying, is the value of b minus a at least twice the value? So that's greater than or equal to twice the value of 3 to the n minus 2 to the n. And that's what we need to test. Statement 1 tells us a is equal to 2 to the n plus 1. And statement and b, this is still statement 1, is equal to 3 to the n plus 1. So let's think about this a little bit. So let's substitute this into this equation. So you get 3 to the n plus 1, 3 to the n plus 1, minus 2 to the n plus 1, is greater than or equal to, and let's multiply this out, 2 times 3 to the n, minus 2 times 2 to the n. So what's 2 times 2 to the n? Well, that's just 2 to the n plus 1. Right? That's just 2 times 2 to the n is 2 to the n plus 1. And there's a minus sign there, so that's where I got it from. So interesting. Just like that, we have a minus 2 to the n plus 1 on both sides. So we can just subtract that from both sides, or add 2 to the n plus 1 from both sides to cancel them out. So we can get rid of that, get rid of that. And then our statement boils down to, is 3 to the n plus 1 greater than or equal to 2 times 3 to the n? Well, we could rewrite 3 to the n plus 1 as 3 times 3 to the n. And we're testing whether that's greater than 2 times 3 to the n. And they tell us that n is a positive number, but that actually doesn't matter. I mean, because we have 3 to the n on both sides, and there's no way you can, even if you rose this to a negative exponent, you would still have a positive number. So you can divide both sides by 3 to the n, and the statement boils down to 3 is greater than 2, which is absolutely correct. So statement 1 is enough information to say whether this statement is true or not, and actually it proves that it's true. Let's look at statement number 2. Statement number 2 tells us that n is equal to 3. N is equal to 3. So let's see. If we look at the original statement, so if n is equal to 3, then we have to say this is what the statement reduces to. It reduces to b minus a is greater than or equal to 2 times 3 to the third power, so that's 27, minus 2 to the third power. Well, 2 to the third is 8. So it reduces to b minus a is greater than or equal to 27 minus 8 is 19 times 2 is 38. Well, I don't know. They don't tell us anything else about b or a or anything, so this is a useless statement. And actually, going through this was a little bit of a waste of time. You could have just said, hey, they tell me what n is. I can come up with a number here, but that still doesn't give me any information over what b or a is. So statement 1 alone is sufficient to answer this question, and 2 is not. Do some, let me go to sky blue. Problem 130. The inflation index for the year 1989 relative to the year 1970 was 3.56, indicating that on average for each dollar spent in 1970 for goods, 3.56 had to be spent for the same goods in 1989. Let me write that down. 1970, $1. In 1986, that same, what is it, 1989 they're talking about, 1989. In that same year, in 1989, that same thing would cost $3.59. $3.56. Getting my sixes and nines confused. $3.56 had to be sent. If the price of a Model K mixer increased precisely according to the inflation index, what was the price of the mixer in 1970? So we want to know the mixer K in 1970. So statement number 1, the price of the Model K mixer was $102.4 more in 1989 than 1970. So let's call this K, we're trying to figure out K70. That's what we're trying to figure out. Mixer K in 1970. So they say the price of the Model K mixer was $102.40 more in 1989 than 1970. So this essentially tells us that mixer K in 19 89 minus mixer K in 1970 is equal to $102.40. But we also have other information. We know that mixer K, it went exactly with inflation, so the increase in inflation price. So we know that, so mixer K in 1989 is equal to 3.56 times mixer K in 1970. Well, how do we know that? Because they told us that mixer K, the price of it, increased directly with this inflation, and anything that was $1, pretty much anything that went with inflation, was worth 3.56 times more in 1989. So mixer K in 89 is 3.56 times more than it was in 1970. So now we have this linear equation, which was given in the problem statement, and we have this linear equation. So we have two equations and two unknowns. So we actually have enough information just with statement one to solve the problem. And I'm actually not even going to go into it because it would be a waste of time. Hopefully we're getting into the rhythm of this. Two linear equations, two unknowns, enough information. If they're quadratic or something, then you'd have to dig a little bit deeper. Statement number two, or if there are somehow parallel equations, but I wouldn't worry about that too much on the GMAT. Statement number two, the price of the Model K mixer was $142.40 in 1989. So they're telling us that K in 1989 was $142.40. Well, this is definitely enough information because we already have this equation that the 89 price, which is $142.40, is equal to 3.56 times the 1970 price. So you just divide this by 3.56 and you have your answer. So each statement independently is enough to solve this problem. Problem 131. Is 5 to the k less than 1,000? So 5 to the k less than 1,000. Statement number 1 tells us that 5 to the k plus 1 is greater than 3,000. I already have a sense this isn't going to help us because it's essentially setting a lower bound on 5 to. So let me just explain it. So 5 to the k plus 1, that's the same thing as 5 to the k times 5. Right? So that's equal to 5 times 5 to the k. Right? You could use this 5 to the first power and then you would add the exponents to get here. And that, they say, is greater than 3,000. You divide both sides by 5 and you get 5 to the k. 5 to the k, that's a k, is greater than 600. That doesn't help us. 5 to the k could be 6,000. Well, 5 to the k could be 700, in which case this would be true. 5 to the k could be 7,000, in which case this wouldn't be true. So statement 1 by itself isn't enough information. Statement number 2 tells us 5 to the k minus 1 is equal to 5 to the k minus 500. This is interesting. So let's see what we can do here. So this is the same thing. Let's get all the k's on one side. So this is the same thing as 5 to the k minus 1 minus 5 to the k is equal to minus 500. And let's just say this is the same thing as 1/5 or 5 to the negative 1. Let me write that. 5 to the negative 1 times 5 to the k, and then minus 5 to the k is equal to minus 500. Let's factor 5 to the k out of this. So you get 5 to the k times 5 to the negative 1, that's 1/5 minus 1, right? We factored a 5 to the k out there, is equal to minus 500. And let's see what we can do. 5 to the k, 1/5 minus 1, that's minus 4/5, right? Times minus 4/5 is equal to minus 500. We can get rid of the minus sign on both sides, multiply both sides by negative 1. And then we can multiply both sides by 5/4. So we get 5 to the k is equal to 500 times, 5 over 4? 5 over 4, and that is what? That's 125, that's 2,500 divided by 4, 125, 2,500 divided by 4, I want to say it's 475, is that? 5/4, no. So each fourth is 125, and you have another, so it's equal to 625. Even if I just got my math wrong, that doesn't matter, because they just want to know whether 5 to the k is less than 1,000, and it definitely is, even if my math. 500 times 5/4, 1/4 of 500 is 125, times 125 times 5, 120, so we'll have one more of those. All right, 625. So statement 2 alone is sufficient to answer the question. Statement 1 was kind of useless. I've run out of time. See you.